Labrit. I guess my Latvian doesn't go much further than that, and Alus Dudzu. So the session will be in English. One pattern that I commonly see when I'm speaking at Agile or Lean events is that people would pop up there and ask for recipes. They would ask how we should work, what method, what practices we should adopt so that we would get better. And I see that pattern as a dysfunctional one. And this is what this session is going to be about, because without understanding the context, without understanding why a specific technique, I'm cutting out, right? That's not me, that's somewhere here. Why specific practices, techniques, or methods worked in the first place, without understanding that, we may as well be applying the wrong thing to our context. And given the opportunity to open this event, I want to leave you with that message. When you will be listening to all other sessions, keep that in mind. Whatever ideas, whatever recipes, whatever practices, techniques, methods speakers would be covering, remember that they need to be put in the context, your context. So for those of you who don't know me, a few words about me. My name is Pawel. I typically don't introduce myself with the surname. It makes things easier. I run Lunar Logic. Lunar Logic is a web software shop in Krakow, Poland. And yes, it is true, we are turning Lunar Logic into no management company, which probably means that my job will soon be irrelevant, I hope. So if you would like to get sense how it is to work with such an organization, we are always looking for more interesting projects to work on. I also run a blog, which you can find at brodzinski.com, where I cover different stuff around lean, Kanban, but also stuff like leadership, like designing organizations, like evolving organizational culture. So lots of interesting stuff. I encourage you to visit the blog. And finally, you can find me on Twitter. My Twitter handle is Pawel Brodzinski. Now, if that session had something like a long title, it would be that. Change programs or improvement initiatives are like teenage sex. Everyone talks about it. Nobody really knows how to do it, but since everyone thinks that everyone else is doing it, they claim that they are doing it too. If you look at our change programs, improvement initiatives from that perspective, you wouldn't expect the success rate, the end results of those change initiatives to be really good, would you? And you would be right. In 1995, John Kotter, basing on his research, published a paper where he said that 70% of change initiatives fail. By that time, it wasn't a big surprise though. He basically repeated what was known from earlier research. But you can say that, you know, this year is going to be the 20th anniversary of this publication. We did improve. Well, no. McKinsey 2008 repeated John Kotter's research. And what they found out? Exactly the same thing. Still, 7 out of 10 change initiatives fail. Bain & Company, different part of the world, the same year, 2008, they're even more pessimistic. They say 70 to 90% of change initiatives fail. In 2013, Ron Ashkenaz, in his Harvard Business Review article, summarized more than 40 years of different research around success rate of change initiatives improvement programs, saying that the bottom line is steady for more than 40 years. 6 to 7 out of 10 improvement initiatives fail. So the picture we are looking at is pretty sad. And in fact, it is even sadder when you look at it from a perspective of last 10 to 15 years and what is happening in our context. What we've seen throughout last 10 years is a huge race of agile, huge race of lean, both movements literally aiming to improve the way we work, to change the company, to change organizations around, to introduce these evolutionary capabilities of improving our teams. And yet we don't see any difference in the bottom line when we are looking at success rate of change initiatives. So to understand why it is happening so, why the picture is so sad, we should first focus on how the change is introduced. And for that, I want to share two models. The first one will be from Virginia Satir. This is this wise lady that you can see on a picture. So Virginia Satir, out of a few great things that she did, is known for her change model, which is also known as a J-curve. So the picture is pretty simple. So what we see here is how our performance changes over time. So first we have a part which is called the old status quo, and we have kind of a steady performance. We are working as we used to, and then we introduce a change. We introduce what she calls a foreign element. What happens then? Anyone has an idea? It goes down. Obviously, it goes down because we are trying this new thing we are not familiar with. We're just learning the ropes, so we won't be as good as we eventually will become. But eventually, we get better and better at it, and we reach a new status quo, which hopefully is better than the old one. Well, this is in the ideal world. In reality, well, performance is not that steady. In reality, the picture looks more like this. And that's okay. I mean, we are not performing exactly the same every single day. But if we look at this picture, there is the other thing happening here. It's not only that average performance went down, it also means that we are less predictable. The variability of performance is much bigger right now. So it's not only that we are, for some time, we're doing worse, we're also less predictable. Now, anyone knows what is happening at that point? At that point, a change agent, the person who introduced the change, gets fired. And the whole change is rolled back. And we reach the point when we are basically lousy at what we do, and we had a serious screw up, and no one wants to continue. And this is why the change gets rolled back. And this change feeds the sad part of the statistics that I brought at the very beginning. Now, the reason is that, which I already mentioned, that we are not only dealing with worse performance for some time, but we are also dealing with bigger risks. So our unpredictability, we may translate it to a scale of risk that we are facing. And suddenly the scale of risk got much wider. And this is one thing. The second thing is that depending on how big the change is, the lead time till the point where we actually see the positive outcomes of a change may be long. If it's too long, if the change is too big, the decision makers won't be patient enough to wait. And this is, by the way, why so many big scale changes, which mean rolling out a new method across the whole organization, fail so miserably. Because the lead time is simply too long. There is another person who you should know when we're talking about change models. This is Stuart Kaufman. What Stuart Kaufman proposed was a fitness landscape. Fitness landscape, we may translate this landscape to the situation where the higher up we are, the more fit for purpose we are, the more fit for purpose our organization is, which translates again to some sort of performance. So let's imagine that we are in a place where the like dot is. What we can do? Well, we can introduce some small changes to climb up our hill. But then any small change would result in worse fitness for purpose, worse performance. Does it mean we are in a perfect pace? Well, no, clearly we see that there are hills that are higher in this landscape. So in such cases, we need to introduce a bigger change. The problem with a bigger change is that we would frequently land in such a place. Well, we are trying to work in a very different way. We may land on a hill that is higher, taller, than the previous one. The problem is that we are landing in the lower point of that hill. And very frequently, it would mean that the change would be rolled back to the old status quo, where we felt really good. And we wouldn't go here. And oh, by the way, when talking about fitness landscape, this is like super oversimplified version of fitness landscape. In reality, what Stuart Kaufman was talking about was not two-dimensional fitness landscape, but three-dimensional fitness landscape. And in fact, when we are talking about our context, it's multidimensional fitness landscape. We may think of a change that would improve quality, but decrease throughput. And these are only two factors that we may take into consideration. There are more. And in fact, this landscape is not stable over time. It's changing. So the simple fact that we are on a top of a peak doesn't mean that we'll be there in a few months. Now, once we know a couple of models for a change and we understand why the change itself happens to be hard, there's another discussion to have, which is what kind of a change we introduce. And this is, in fact, even more important part of that discussion. Because what we see typically is that people are copying recipes. People are copying practices. And this is, in fact, something that happened during the early days of Agile. So we've had those first Agile organizations, and they were doing better than other organizations. So early adopters started thinking, well, they're doing something right. They started looking at those organizations, and they figured that, you know, there are those practices, and they started copying those. The thing with early adopters, though, is that early adopters are very aware. They're tinkerers. They would look at the things that they are doing, and they would look, well, this works, this doesn't work, let's tweak it. So we've seen more of early successes, and then we started codifying the methods, and then they became recipes, and then we are blindly applying them. And we lost something on the way. We lost some of the initial mindset that made that thing work in the first place. And right now, when we are copying practices are obviously the most visible parts of what we are doing. Frequently, though, they are the least important parts of what we are doing. There's an interesting story from early 80s. Managers from American automotive industry realized how badly Japanese were kicking their butts. So they figured, well, let's go to Japan, let's see what they're doing differently. And surprising thing was that Japanese were super open, super transparent to those American managers. So what happened? They showed them everything, like factory floors, workflows, they described their processes, they described their practices, they told them virtually everything. And it was surprising because they were direct competitors. Nevertheless, Americans took notes, got back to US, implemented all that stuff. And what happened? Well, pretty much nothing, except of those places where things got worse. Because what Americans didn't understand, and Japanese perfectly understood, was that practices alone were not enough to copy the success. For Japanese, lean manufacturing, the key part of lean manufacturing was the organizational culture, and Japanese knew that. And organizational culture cannot be simply copied. And the same thing we are doing with Agile methods. We are copying practices, and then we are wondering, well, it doesn't really work. Why? So instead of focusing on practices, we should think of what's beyond practices. And the thinking model I like to use is an iceberg. As with an iceberg, there is a part that is afloat, that is clearly seen. This would be practices. This is what we see. But the much bigger part, much more important part, the part that keeps the whole iceberg afloat, is what's below the waterline. And this would be principles that we've had in mind when we're formulating those practices. And even deeper, values that we shared that made us came up with those principles. So let me give you a few examples. Anyone familiar with this? I know it's morning, so I started with an easy example. It's Scrum. But I don't want to focus on the whole Scrum. I want to pick one of the practices of Scrum, which is time boxing or iterations. So iterations are this nice concept that provide kind of a regular rhythm of delivery, that provide predictability, that typically shorten feedback cycles with our clients. All good stuff, right? Now, does anyone know this company? Simple questions for the morning. Does anyone know, a more difficult question, does anyone know how frequently Amazon deploys their software to production? Every dozen seconds or so on average, several thousand times a day. Several thousand times a day. Now, let's run a quick thought experiment. What would happen if Amazon decided to adopt Scrum by the book with, say, biweekly iterations? I would say that the capabilities to maintain their site, let alone add new features, would disappear overnight. They wouldn't be able to run their business. I mean, come on, time boxing, good practice. Another example from systems thinking domain. Edwards Deming, godfather of systems thinking, a person without whom there would be no lean as we know it. He's attributed with those words that 95% of performance is attributable to the system, not to the individuals, which means we should focus on the system, not on individual performance of people. Well, in fact, Deming was saying something slightly different. He was saying that 95% of performance variability is attributable to the system, which is a common misconception. And performance variability and controlling performance variability was one of Deming's obsessions. He was all about keeping system under statistical control. He was all about designing system in a way that it would produce predictable outcomes. Good stuff. One of pillars of Lean. Now, does anyone know this company? Well, does anyone know Angry Birds? This is the studio behind Angry Birds. Now, how do you think would Rovio be all about learning from Deming and applying the ideas for limiting performance variability? Do you know which game of Rovio Angry Bird was? 52nd. How do you think would Rovio like Angry Birds to be predictable, mediocre, lukewarm success? Angry Birds to be predictable, mediocre, lukewarm success the same way as the first 51 games were? Or they would prefer it the way it really happened? Another example, really close to my heart, visualization. So visualization provides us better understanding of work, better understanding of the processes we follow, better understanding of where we have queues, where we have blockers, all the good stuff. We know more. We make better everyday decisions. In fact, there was at one of Kanban leadership retreats, there was a discussion which order we should use when we are introducing practices of the Kanban method. And there was a heated discussion, you know, whether introducing WIP limits should go early or should go late. And there was really no agreement. One thing, though, everyone agreed on universally: visualization always goes first. I mean, it's just this practice that allows us to harvest low-hanging fruits. So let me use another example. One of European daughter companies of eBay was rolling out Kanban across multiple teams. In one of the teams, and obviously they started with visualization, in one of the teams, the Kanban implementation didn't go really well. In fact, they struggled with even simple visualization. The team it was a team of software architects. The team wouldn't keep board up to date. It quickly became useless. They really resisted something as simple as a visual board. When coaches started digging up, they realized that the problem was that those software architects were accomplishing very, very little. So they would go to meetings, they would have discussions, but work wouldn't get done. So they felt that visualization is a threat to their sense of safety. No wonder that they resisted change, even though the practice seems to be universally nice. Another example, Gemba walk. The idea to go and see the work, how the work gets done. Gemba walk is an interesting practice because it is described in pretty much every serious book on Lean that is out there. This is like an internal part of Lean. So let me use an example from another, hopefully soon to be famous, company, which is Neurologic. So I went for a Gemba walk the other day, and this is what I've seen. I guess the work gets done, I hope. The difference is that in our context, work is invisible. We cannot simply go and see factory floor, see piles of parts queuing up before in front of machines. This is, by the way, why visualization is typically so valuable, because it provides us proxy information of what is happening. Where are the queues? Where are the blockers? Where are the bottlenecks? But in our context, simply going and seeing the work doesn't really work. We would see just, you know, people sitting by the computers, maybe chatting, maybe discussing, and that's it. So this is why we need to understand more. Because otherwise, we may either way be applying a practice to the context where it wouldn't really work. We need to understand what principles drove that practice in the first place. There is one practice, the most popular practice, agile practice that is out there is stand-up meetings. Who does stand-up meetings? Lots of, keep your hands up. Keep your hands up if you had an explicit discussion with your team why you are doing stand-up meetings, what kind of value you expect to get from those stand-up meetings. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up if you had a explicit discussion with your team why stand-up meetings was initially a part of the method you are using, what it was supposed to accomplish. 1/3 of initial hands? This is a typical, thank you. This is a typical result. This is like, okay, we started thinking why that practice was a part of what we were doing. Why that practice, what authors of that practice had in mind initially when they were proposing it. Only then we can put it in the context. And we can do that for pretty much every practice that we can adopt. So let me go again through those stories, and let me try to help you to figure out what principles and what values were behind specific practices that I mentioned and why it wouldn't work in those specific contexts. So first, time boxing or iteration. Time boxing provides us a predictable rhythm of work, a shorter feedback loop, so it would be about On values level, it would be about predictability. It would be about better communication, probably. Does Amazon care about those things? Probably yes, but not as much as they do care about the capabilities for rapid experimenting, for creativity. They're not ready to sacrifice those to optimize for predictability. So there is a misalignment on values level. Limiting performance variability and Rovio. Rovio, as most of startups, is not about controlling the outcomes of the work, making them predictable. They actually want to run experiments. They are okay to fail many times, as long as there is a huge success at the end of the road. As Mark Cuban says, in business, to be a success, you need to be right only once. And he knows what he's saying, because he was right once, and now he owns an NBA club, and he's basically a celebrity. So in the startup context, we actually want to be unpredictable. Pretty much the opposite of what Deming was proposing in the context of lean manufacturing. Visualization provides us better understanding of work, of the status of work, of the processes we follow, better understanding of bottlenecks, blockers, etc., etc., etc. It provides us transparency. This is the value behind visualization. In the context of the company, daughter company of eBay and the team of software architects, well, did they care about transparency? Maybe yes, maybe not. They definitely did care about their sense of safety. And this is, in fact, a value that is present universally across all organizations. All people want to feel safe at work. They don't want to be threatened that they may be sacked any time. So it doesn't matter whether you realize that or not. This value is present in your organization. And if something, in this case, transparency, goes against that, you may expect resistance. And this is exactly what happened. Gemba Walk and our case at Lunar. This is actually an interesting example because in terms of principles and values, there is this alignment. When we are talking about Gemba Walk, again, we are talking about understanding how we work. We are talking about transparency. We are also talking about removing impediments. So we would be talking about efficiency. We totally subscribe to that at Lunar. The thing is that since the context of work has changed, we are not working on physical parts. We are working on the code, invisible code. A specific practice doesn't work anymore. In fact, Russell Ackoff says that, another systems thinker, that system is not a sum of its parts. It's the outcome of interactions between those parts. So if we treat our teams as systems, and they are systems, the parts would be individuals, individual contributors. We shouldn't be focusing on how each of individuals contribute to the work of a team. We should be looking at collaboration. And we wouldn't see collaboration when we are with a team for 15 minutes. We have to be there in the long run, all the time. And only then we can see collaboration. We can see how people talk with each other, how they solve problems, how they discuss, all that stuff. This would be the outcome of our system. So suddenly, we see that practices that seem to be universally good have to be put in the context, and we actually can figure out whether they would work or not, whether it is even worth trying to introduce them. Now, another example, when we are talking about principles, comes from Kanban method. Kanban method is one of those methods that I really like because it provides not only practices, but also principles. These are principles of Kanban method. And interestingly enough, whenever I'm training Kanban, people would frequently mention practices related to Kanban, visualization, limiting working progress, managing flow, etc. They would very frequently forget about principles. And principles, Kanban principles, describe what I call a mindset that is required to succeed when introducing Kanban. So if you don't agree with those principles, you may not want to start introducing Kanban because it may yield very mediocre results. And let me use one of the examples. The last principle says encourage leadership on all levels. And this is an example from the company of where my friend works for. It will remain anonymous. Because what my friend says is that despite the fact that it is fun for him to help the organization change, to help the organization improve, and he knows how to do it in that context, he has neither positional power nor authority to do that. And note, he's not just a developer. He's a line manager. What does it say about encouraging leadership on all levels in that organization? It does say that they don't do it. So if they approached me and told me, hey, Pawel, can you help us roll out Kanban across the whole organization? I would be no. It would be a waste of my time and your money. Just look at those principles. Figure out how to fix them first, because otherwise, the outcomes of introducing a new method would be super, super, super limited, or you would fail ultimately altogether. So this is why we need to understand principles and values behind practices. And in fact, there are two icebergs. One iceberg is built around practices. So say a method, like in the case of Kanban. The other iceberg is built for an organization. Each organization follows some principles. Each organization lives by some values. And to understand whether there is this alignment or not, we need to understand both parts. So far, we focused on practices, methods, techniques. Let's focus on organization. How to figure out what principles and what values our organization cares about? Well, obviously, our organization would have their mouths full of good stuff like customer satisfaction, high quality, people. Does anyone work for a company that wouldn't claim that they do care about customer satisfaction, high quality, and people? I've seen one person who raised the hand, and he was like, "We don't care about customer satisfaction. I work for Ryanair." That stuff would end up in things like mission statements or visions. So, like, quick check: does anyone can quote your mission, the mission statement of your company from the top of your head, or a vision? No one? Damn. You don't seem to give a damn, do you? But actually, that's not a problem. That's not a problem, and I will tell you why in a second. Because one thing is what organizations claim to be. We do care about high quality and customer satisfaction and all this stuff. The other thing is how people really behave. And you would see those organizations that claim to care about customer satisfaction and high quality, and then you would see a line manager telling their people to sell some bullshit to their client because they don't want to inform the client that they are late with the project. Does it mean that they do care about customer satisfaction? No. Then you would see a project manager telling developers, you know, TDD, you can't do that. We don't have time for unit tests. And per programming, two people, one computer, we don't have time for that. It's not efficient. You can't do that here. Does it mean that they care about high quality? No. So very frequently what you would see is huge authenticity gap. One thing is what an organization claims to be, a pretense, as Stephen Parry named it. The other thing is how people in that organization really behave. And the higher up in the hierarchy they are, the more important their behaviors are, because they influence a bigger part of an organization. And the claim, what an organization claims to be, is not really important. What is important is how people really behave. So when people ask me about organizational culture, about the values that the organization cares about, I would first look at a CEO, how they behave. It would tell you half of the story. So when you're looking at our iceberg, you should be looking at the real behaviors from an organization and then trying to compare it with principles and values that are cornerstones for a practice or a method. Now, when we're talking about the values of an organization, it's not a binary question. It's not either or kind of question. So what you see here are values. Again, I'm using Kanban as an example. So what you see here are values for the Kanban method. And this is the work of Mike Barrows. So what Mike Barrows did, he took practices and principles of the Kanban method, and he kind of derived values behind. So he did the homework, the iceberg homework for us in the context of Kanban. So there are 9 values of Kanban method. Now you can look at your at an organization and try to figure out whether those values are shared across that organization. And we may take transparency as an example. So we may take transparency and realize that, you know, on a team level, transparency works perfectly. You know, within a team, team members are perfectly open with each other. They do have a visual board. They keep that board up to date. They share all the all the relevant information with each other, etc., etc., etc. We have perfect transparency on a team level. The same team may not be that transparent in front of the other team, because the other team is working on that doomed project, and our team may not be willing to share how much slack they have, because otherwise one or two developers from our team would be pulled to the doomed project. Our team may not be as transparent in front of a senior manager, telling them that, well, we are late with a project because they got burned a few times before. And oh, by the way, that manager wouldn't be transparent in front of the team either when it comes to share the news about this reorganization that is in flight. And our team wouldn't be that transparent in front of a client, because telling that client that we are late with a project, because, well, this is how the whole organization works, that we don't tell bad news to the clients. So is transparency on a list of our values or not? Are we transparent or not? There's no simple answer. It's not either or kind of question. It's not even a simple scale. It's a multidimensional scale. We may be transparent in one context and not transparent in the other. So when we are thinking about organizational values and how a specific method would work or not work in our context, we need to take that into consideration. So in that context, if someone asked me, does it make sense to introduce Kanban in such an organization, I would say yes, although do remember that the outcomes of such implementation would be limited to the team level, to the level where transparency works. So when we are talking about introducing Kanban method, we frequently say about scaling it wide and deep. So we are talking about covering the whole value stream with Kanban and going to the different levels of work. One of the things that I'm dealing with is portfolio Kanban, for example, how to apply Kanban on portfolio level. In this case, the outcomes of introducing Kanban would be limited to team level, and it wouldn't go wider or deeper than that. So it is worth to remember. I will be showing you the iceberg till you remember it. And anytime someone gives you a recipe, remember it's just a tip of the iceberg. And your homework is to figure out what's underwater. So before starting with any method, especially if you are thinking about the whole method, not a small practice, but the whole method, remember, what are the principles? Figure out what are the principles and values that are cornerstones of that method. And then figure out what are principles and values that your organization lives by. And only if there is alignment between those two, go for it. If there is no alignment, you may want to reconsider whether you are ready or whether a method or a practice or a technique is applicable in your context. Because only mindful use of practice leads to learning. When we understand why we are doing what we are doing, why we are introducing a specific change, we stand a chance of succeeding. And even if we would fail, as in the example with a Gemba walk, where we've had this alignment on principles and values level, even if we don't succeed, we would learn. If we are copying recipes, if we are applying practice mindlessly, we would end up with a cargo cult. And cargo cults, as we know, don't work. And since I've just done super weird thing, and I just quoted myself. With that, Liel's part, yes. And we have a few minutes for questions, I guess.
Please, don't be shy.
Thank you. How to prevent implementing cargo cult in your company? Is this clear?
Just don't. So I guess I tried to answer that question for past 40 minutes or so. Like the answer, the short version of the long answer is understanding. Understand why. What's behind a practice, behind a method, and figure out whether it fits your organizational culture. But the other part of the answer is, depending on how much positional power you have, sometimes you can't prevent that. So you are down to limiting that damages. So sometimes you may be forced to, you know, to be the part of, we adopt Scrum kind of initiative, and the best thing you can do is, again, use understanding of, you know, why Scrum is defined the way it is, what's in it for you, and pick the parts that would be useful for you, but you may not have enough power to change the effort of the whole organization. And the problem with such situations is that frequently, and I've seen that happening a lot. Frequently, when the change eventually is rolled back, like in J-curve model, it's not only that we rolled it back and the guy who came up with the idea is not a good guy anymore, but it's also this thing that we have tried is now officially a bad thing. And I've seen that happening with all sorts of agile methods. I mean, we tried Scrum and it totally didn't work, so Scrum is bad. We tried Kanban and it totally didn't work, and so Kanban is bad. While, you know, we were just applying a recipe without understanding that. So I guess I have two answers to that.
First, I think, thank you for a great speech. I think from the tweets I read, everybody loved it. The question is more that you are kind of stressing that if your organization's values are aligned with the values underlying some particular method, then it's good for you and then go for it. But the million-dollar question, of course, is what if they aren't? I have an organization and the values, they're not really good. I don't like them. And I want to change them. So what would be your suggestion then? Should I go for a method as a tool to change the values of my organization or not?
So there are two approaches. There is one approach which I'm personally not a fan of, fake it till you make it, which goes, okay, so we want to change some of our behaviors, so let's pretend we do have that situation that we want to have, and we work like we had it, and eventually we will learn that. I personally didn't see much of that happening, although there is good psychological ground for that as well. So I don't say it's useless crap. Personally, and you touched one of my pet peeves, I would start working on organizational culture, which is, and I would really love to have a 2-minute long answer for you, but it's like 2-day long answer for you, and it probably wouldn't fully satisfy you anyway. But there are tools to evolve organizational culture. The smaller the company is, the bigger the impact you would have on it. So if you are talking about Accenture and a single individual, you know, the impact of a single individual on the organizational culture of Accenture would be like super, super, super minimal, unless it is a CEO or like very senior person. So sometimes those efforts may be doomed by default. But it doesn't mean that the company culture cannot be changed. And I've seen that, for example, in our case, in Lunar case, over the course of like a couple of years, it's a completely different company. So it's doable, and I'm happy to have kind of long discussion in a hallway. You know, what are the tools to that? Because I don't have 2 minute long answer.
All right. Any more questions? We have place for one more. Well, I have one. So if you're talking about the mindset of the company, and that is a big part of the iceberg, right? So how do you encourage your company to move forward? How do you sell that to people? Is there a trick that you use?
There is no trick. It's very contextual. A lot depends on what you want to achieve. So one of the examples, just to tease a little bit of no management thingy, one of the examples that that was really difficult when we were trying to chase no management way of working was how decisions are made. Because typically, you know, the power is assigned to managers. Managers use that power to make decisions, and by basically, this is how power is used in the context of a knowledge work. So, how to encourage people to start making decisions, because they were never making those decisions. So, the first thing that needed to happen was to create space for them. Which is interesting because it meant that whoever had that power before needed to restrain from making any decisions. And so this was the first step. And the second step was to restrain from correcting the bad decisions. Because, you know, if you tried hard and made your call, and like, no, that doesn't make sense. This was your last attempt. So and it works in all context. You want people to self-organize. Just stop micromanaging them. Even go too far, like restraining yourself from helping them to do so. Even if you have a good advice for them. If you want people to start managing the flow and they don't like your physical board and they prefer electronic tool, it doesn't matter that you actually know that physical board would work better for them. Let them do what they prefer to do. Let them make their mistakes. Don Reinertsen says that if you want, he's saying that about decentralizing control. If you want people to start taking initiative, you need to provide them with information, which is obvious, authority, so they need to know that they are supposed to make those decisions, and practice. They need to start doing that, and occasionally fail. And they need to know that they are okay with that.
Thank you. A very good answer.